quiet moment. We only need Lord officially to, as you were, to thank you as you, as ever, the living one among us, in us, through us, as you always are, and to thank you as a fellowship, as we're meeting you for this hour. Once again, you unveil yourself in whatever ways you know you will meet. So here we are, thanking you, anticipating the words you speak, which are spirit and life. Thank you, Lord. Amen. I seem to have fallen among thieves. Tommy steals all I want to say, and I've got nothing for me to say. I'm sure you're all blessed to our depths this morning. And Jen, too, on the same line, the one person coming to all. Evidently, the Lord speaking by the same voice through us all. Once again, as I said previously, I somewhat feel it's like you've had good, warm flesh, and now you've got to split the flesh open and find there's some bones underneath. At least the flesh needs some bones to keep it in its proper shape. That's about it. Tommy, by the Spirit, so wonderfully this morning opened up to us. The fact, which is the basis of this life we're talking about, using the various terms such as the... Is that going wrong? Oh. Oh. Thank you. Thank you. The baptism of the Spirit, centering on the fact that it is a living union, unity. I'll later on say why I prefer the word unity to union, between the person, and we as derivative persons, and such a union and unity that we just live naturally. And yet, deep down in the centre of our consciousness, it isn't we. But he. In a sense, perhaps, what I'm saying this afternoon will be the least interesting, perhaps the driest of the five talks we're seeking to give, because I only want to go over with you the why of the unity or the union. On what solid foundation can we say that? So I'm only, as I say, opening up, see what lies behind. Therefore, it is, in a sense, commonplace to us all, or most of us here, I hope. Just a reminder. But as I say, I've always been one that feels I must have my feet on earth, solid. I know the way is under me by walking on it. There mustn't be any questions with me why it should be so and how it can be so. So we're looking at that this afternoon. We've seen all through these talks this one fact, that there's this one person. We needn't go over that again, we've gone over it again and again. This one person. This one person who is love, which means he lives other people's lives. He really is other people, get down to it. Being spirit, he must have his means of manifestation. All manifests him, as Glenn's been pointing out to us. But supremely, persons manifest him because he's a person. Therefore, the reason for our creation is to be in such a natural unity that we are as he is. As Tom pointed out so plainly, not by imitation, but impartation. Know how we live like that. So we're the eternal love. As he is, so we are the eternal love. We're other people. This is what comes out. Tommy underlined that again this morning. That whatever term we may use, Pentecost, baptism of the Spirit, our sanctification, purity, whatever it is, it only has one meaning to it ultimately. A union relationship between him and us. A unity between us. So we are he and we, such a relationship that it, as it were, turns out to be just he, I beg your pardon, turns out to be just we, but it's really he. This is the paradox we get onto. On what basis can we live naturally? Questioning this basic fact of this unity, he and we, he by we, he by us, we as he, whatever phrase we like to use. Now we left it yesterday afternoon at the point of the fact that there's another he who's captured humanity. It's not that he. He's only a created he, but he's a God, and he's called the God of this world. And John stated to us that there are two he's, and one he lives in the unredeemed, and the other he lives in the redeemed. So he said, greater he is in you, the redeemed, than he is in the world. And gave them their names, and hereby know we the Spirit of truth, that is the person who is the truth in the believer, and the Spirit of error, that is the person, the God, who is the error in the unbeliever. So the relationship and the condition in which we come into this world is a wrong God in us, and a wrong God by us. The God of self-centeredness. You say the God of self-giving. The false one. Now we discussed that yesterday, we even discussed that again today, I take it. But what we've got to find out is the means by which, on the grounds upon which, there's been a change of gods. Because there's always. Always for humanity, the only possibility for humanity is a change of gods. The God being the inner person, so joined to us that we spontaneously function as he functions. How can the wrong one be out and the right one be in? There's a permanency. So we can forget it and live. So you see, I'm going back in a sense to common places. The foundation of the gospel, but just to give, it's helpful to give the re-examination of those foundations. We saw yesterday also that we're in a hopeless condition. We're captive. We cannot get out. We're captured. One of the scripture expressions, we're slaves. Slaves of the devil. Slaves of the spirit of self-centeredness. We're captured. We can't get out of it. The only way we can be out is if somebody else gets us out. Who can get us out? No man can get men out. Because we're one of us. And so we get the great revelation of the gospel. Which is, of course, the perfect revelation, of course, of the kind of person God is. What love means, it exists for need, it belongs to need. It's the possession of need. Needs the creditor, loves the debtor. And where there's need, love belongs to that need. And the supreme need of the human race we've been caught up with the wrong God and going in the wrong direction. And living, and if it should be so, living eternally in the consequent distortions. Therefore, the gospel is, this person, this living person himself, being the one who rescues us. And rescue means the means by which, as I said yesterday, he regains his stolen property. God couldn't create higher than humanity, because you can't create higher than yourself. And he created us in his similitude, in his likeness. Because only he as a person functions through persons. So it's the very topmost of his creation which has been lost to him and become a stolen property. And the whole human creation, expressing all forms of the activity of self-centeredness, well, we're meant to express all the forms of the activity of self-giving. Self-love, self-giving. So there's no other purpose in redemption than that God should regain his total property and be able naturally and easily, through time and eternity, to express himself in infinite variety of self-giving love and self-giving activity, instead of humanity expressing the wrong God in all forms of self-seeking. This we know how it is done, by God becoming a man. The Bible leaves us no question about that, because John says that he was this one who came was the Word. He was with God. He was God, and the Word was made flesh. So he said, "This one on earth was God." John says, as definitely as Paul says it. Paul says God was manifest in the flesh. Now this is a tremendous fact. Fact far beyond reason, that the one who is fantastic to reason, the one who is in a sense the universe itself, the upholder of the universe, the one who expressed himself through the universe, became a tiny part of it, a human. I don't ultimately base my faith on trying to stretch my reason to believe things or not believe things. I base my faith ultimately, what I might call is my instinctive ideal. In this, I can ever conceive anything more wonderful than a God whose real life is living the lives of the people the people he creates. I can't conceive of one, a God who's only interested to be us, to live our lives. So his life, his joy, his gaieties, his fulfillment is being us, being we. I can't conceive any higher than a love like that. When that love has been exemplified on earth by a person who did that, I'll bet my life on that for God. I'll take all the rest in. So I never had any difficulty with liberalism and so on. So I say, well, until you find me a better God, I'm going to have this one. I'm waiting. That's all. he hasn't turned up yet. I, with all my being, I see in God my ultimate. I can't conceive a higher ultimate. All right, I'll bet my life on my ultimate. And I'll choose the right horse and I'll win in the end. That's all. So I don't base my faith really on historic facts. Basically, I gather in all historic facts because if it's centered on that person, I'll take the lot. So on that basis, I'll take the whole Bible. If she took the whole Bible, I'll take the whole Bible. The way in which completed for us a total deliverance, without one crack in it, is known to us. That's what the Bible presents. And all those who interpret Jesus Christ and him crucified to us on earth bear the same message. So if we turn one down, we turn the lot down. Paul says the same, and John says the same, and James says the same, and Peter says the same. That's all that's left, except Jude. He only goes about 30 verses, so he says the same too. the whole lot says the same. So we're looking at this fact now. We may say a leap of faith, unless, as I say, if to you this is the only conceivable God that could be, all right, then it's easy to take in what he said. by faith. That this was God become man, as a man, to redeem man. First of all, of course, he had to be one who couldn't himself become a captive to the wrong God. That had to be 4001. So he himself refused every kind of solicitation or enticement to become captive to the wrong God which had captured the first Adam. Therefore, he was in the condition in which he was free from the captivity and its consequences which seized upon the human race of which he was a member. So he went through a process which could produce for us a deliverance without a crack in it, an entire salvation, redemption, whatever we like to call it. This was, of course, through the process of Christ dying, Christ rising, and ultimately Christ ascending, although we shan't touch on that last one this morning, this afternoon. Christ dying, Christ rising. The Bible divides the effects of Christ dying and rising into two distinct areas presented to us in two distinct forms in the scriptures, namely by the Apostle Paul, who is the one who really opens up the whole matter for us. The others do too, but he gives us the whole structure of salvation. You may speak of the two stages of redemption as Christ for us and Christ as us, with their different effects. Christ for us and Christ as us. It's pictured for us also in a little statement which kind of slips in to one of the comments on the Lord's Supper made by the Apostle Paul in the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians. When he speaks about the Lord's Supper, in just passing remarks, so much often great truth comes in passing remarks, as you know. And he speaks about the cup of blessing which we bless. Is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? And the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the blood of the body of Christ? I'm just quoting. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? Now, having said that, spoken of the communion of the blood of Christ, the communion of the body of Christ, he goes on saying, for we being many are one bread and one body. He doesn't say one blood. You'd think he'd say, is this not the communion of the blood of Christ? Is it not the communion of the body of Christ? We being many are one bread, one blood, one body. He doesn't say that. He doesn't say, we being many are one blood. He says, we being many are one bread, one body, but the bread being equivalent to the body. There's reason for that. Because there's one necessary preliminary, first necessary part of our redemption, which is something we couldn't touch, which he had to do for us apart from us. So we're not the blood. The blood is his life, not that. We're the body, which is not quite as close as the blood, but we're the blood. We're not the blood. We're the body. So it doesn't connect us in that way with the blood. Because for this first part, there had to be someone who did something for us, apart from us, which he couldn't do for ourselves. Because we're caught up in a permanent condition of everlasting separation from God. The scriptural phrase is eternal destruction from the presence of the Lord. It must be. A race captured by a God of self-centeredness cannot live side by side with a race captured by God self-giving. They won't work. They won't be too friendly up there any more than they are down here. Won't work. It's impossible. There must be an everlasting separation between the two. So we're caught up in this everlasting separation, which is consequences of death. Sorry read to us. Sin refuses death, and after death, remaining in what all the whatever the consequences are of everlasting separation. To remain in the consequences of an everlasting separation means to be remaining in the consequences of self-centered life. Well, we get little of the hell you get from self-centered down here. So a faint shadow of what can be when there's no comfort. We can comfort ourselves sometimes a little down here by nice food and nice things and nice so-and-so. When there was sickness, nothing except our burning desires, it won't be a pleasant life. Hell starts inside here, but we get a little comfort up here. When we're stripped, what comfort? So we're caught up in a separation which is everlasting. In which, of course, are involved the sins of which we're conscious, and the guilt as a consequence of them, and all that we speak of as our lost conditions. Now Christ, on Calvary, shedding his precious blood for us, means the infinite and eternal one giving up his infinity and eternity for us. That's what he did. He was the one who need never have died. He said so. No, no man taketh it from me. I lay down my life of myself. This was the one who never need die. And he was always giving up his right to an unbroken eternal life to be us and for us after to take upon himself a separation which has captured us all. So the Bible presents us with him on Calvary, in this aspect, a shadowed all through Scripture. If you eliminate the blood of Christ, you eliminate the Bible. The two side by side. We begin the equivalent of the blood of Christ in Abel. The first person of Christ there had to be a substitutionary sacrifice for his sins, right the way through the Bible. Until we come out at the final prophecy before Jesus Christ came, behold the Lamb of God. The scapegoat that took the sins into the wilderness and so on. The whole Bible says it on there. Eliminate the blood, eliminate the Bible. Eliminate the blood, eliminates redemption. In whom we have redemption through his blood. The forgiveness of sins. The blood means an eternal life taking a temporal death for our sakes. That's what blood. Blood is a light. Blood is the evidence that the life's gone out. And the blood means that therefore an eternal life, given up being eternal and taking upon itself the temporal death which is the effect of sin, which would go on into a death being a separation from God, would go on eternally, taking upon itself. And causing him to use such expressions as, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Well, I never was forsaken because he was actually God himself. It was God forsaking God, as it were. And ending by saying, it is finished. All that he claimed to be finished would have been meaningless unless he'd been raised from the dead. The only proof that the sacrifice was efficacious was that the one who made it was raised from the dead. That was evidence the whole thing was entirely accepted and entirely finished. That's why Paul says he was raised again for our justification. Justification is a far, far profounder, more marvelous word than forgiveness. Forgiveness is human, can be. Justification is beyond. Forgiveness means, well, if I've wronged you, you might forgive me. I couldn't be quite sure you'd forget it. And I'm sure I shouldn't forget it. There's an element in forgiveness which isn't complete enough. You might forget it or might not. I'm sure I shouldn't. Justification is amazing. It means you are as if the thing was never there. That's blotting up. I'm always there. I've had 47 years of foundation on that. I'm always there. It hasn't been sort of, well, I was put on forgiveness somehow. No, there's a basis to this. I don't pretend to understand it all. I dig and so I think I don't pretend to understand. But I understand enough for it presented to me. That all that would cause me to admit I'm a sinner, which I am, and the guilty which I am, and a rebel against God which I am, and justifiably under condemnation as having broken the eternal law. There's only one law in the universe. The law is a convenient term we use for the way a thing works. Quite a simple word. You talk about a law of something when you test the way it works. For instance, Newton thought he found the law of gravity. Of course, Einstein tried to disagree with him, but if you understand Einstein, God bless you. But the law of gravity, what does it mean? Well, there's something that works this way. There's something that works the way, if you do drop a cup, it'll break. Well, the consequences of broken law are drop the cup. Defy the law, and at least in the days when you've got decent china cups, you get a broken cup. So there's an effect of broken law. All those things are involved. I may not fully understand it, but therefore, the whole of life is broken law. Why? There's only one law of the universe. The law of the universe is the way God works. How does God work? He's love. That's all there is in the universe. The law is the way a thing works. How does the universe work? By a person who's love, nothing else. So everything which isn't self-giving love is broken law. And there's only one who is self-giving love, and that's God. So only so far as God is operating by you, is there unbroken law in you. All the rest is a broken law. So poor us. We're for it. And that simply is made of the fact that our effects are broken law. Now, I couldn't, mounting all those up, what real foundation do I have to say, oh, they aren't there? Unless they're presented with this gospel, this way of redemption worked out by God. It reveals that he himself became a person. You see, he could represent humanity because he was humanity. That's the deity. He was humanity. He's the basic humanity, so he has the right to represent humanity. And Galileo took the name Son of Man. It's a good term, sort of general term. He didn't call himself something else, just Son of Man or Jesus Savior, which is what I mean. But he was humanity. All right then, he could be humanity. This is the leap of faith. God is manifest in the flesh. And this person giving up what was his normal relationship, normal condition, eternal life, giving it up. Becoming what we are, a person under death. In other words, he took upon himself the curse of, it says, everyone hanging on a tree, cursed is everyone hanging on a tree and so on. The condemnation, the judgment, took it upon himself. Well, I may not understand it all, but I understand that's enough. That in the resurrection, God's saying, this person is perfectly righteous. What he went through isn't there any longer. And therefore, if I related to him by faith, it's not there with me any longer. Nothing is, it's not there. It's as if he never was there. It never come to me again. I'm out. I'm as sinless in God's sight as his own son is. Righteous in God's sight as his own son is. That's it. Declared righteous. That's his foundation there. I find a freedom in it. So I don't jump into a vague thing called forgiveness, not quite sure how it comes. I'm on a foundation. The basis of our freedom. And ultimately, of course, the basis of our continual cleansing. That doesn't quite come up now, but when we know this fact, we'd also learn in our daily lives, it says quick sinning, there's quick cleansing. Because God's attitude never changes. Actually, it never did. Because in God's sight, the Lamb was saved from the foundation of the world. Indeed, God's a queer person, because he provides remedies before there are needs for them. The Bible says he foreordained Jesus to be Savior before there was sin for saving from, to save us from. That was a bit funny. We usually have the need first and then the supply afterwards. He has a supply first and digs a hole for the need, then puts a supply into it. We're the holy dog. So God's, thank God, he has his own business. And, I like that one. I haven't heard that before, Tommy, the devil's an ass. I think it's a great one. I agree with you. Oh, my. Now, what is yet more important for us, and thank God, wonderfully realized by so many of us here, that's not enough. If that's all redemption is, that's not enough. I told you that the Bible presents us, peculiarly Paul, the process of redemption, Christ crucified, Christ risen, in two distinct stages, phases. What word to use? Departments? Is that the right word to use? Why isn't it enough? Because my ultimate problem isn't the sins I commit, it's the sin that commits them. It's the sin spirit which motivates me is my problem. The sins I produce, which have caused me to be an expressed as life of self-centeredness, are a product of the sin spirit which has got me. The he that's in the world, the spirit of the world, the spirit of error. Jesus made very plain. Jesus said some things we don't always like. He said to the Pharisees, but we also are Pharisees until we were saved, perhaps we get a little Phariseeism every now and then as well as after we are saved too. But he said this, he said to the Pharisees, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He didn't say that you're us. He says, you are your father the devil, lust of your father, because in this spiritual relationship your father's inside you. Just the same as the heavenly father's inside Jesus, so the wrong father's inside the unredeemed. And you're expressing his lustiness through you. This was the comment that was made in 1 John chapter 3, I should say, where it spoke of about loving your brother and not being like Cain. Interesting what he says. He says, love your brethren, don't be like Cain, who was of that wicked one and slew his brother. Why put those words of that wicked one in? Why not just say, don't be like Cain who slew his brother, because it wasn't Cain who slew his brother. There was a hater and murderer inside Cain who merely used Cain as his agent. That's what humanity is. The wicked one was the one who hated and murdered through Cain, and Cain was the agent. So you see, I'm getting at this. Redemption is hopelessly incomplete if it merely removes the consequences of my sins, which have separated me from God, and don't remove the motivator. And replace it by a new motivator. The spirit of holiness instead of the spirit of sin, if you like. The spirit of self-giving love instead of the spirit of self-loving love. Unless it does that, it's incomplete. I was saying, I think I moved off at the moment. I was saying in the middle there, I find at my age my memory sometimes gives me a jump or two. So if you apologize if I miss a point or two. But I was saying about that quick sealing, quick cleansing. I was jumped off there saying, now, of course, in God's sight, we're reconciled. He never needed to be reconciled to us. Oh, no. He had to fulfill a process which could reconcile us to him, which could make it possible for us to come back to him. So he's always reconciled. I mean, therefore, there's never a need for us to remain in guilt when we do fall into sin. We can, as quickly as we fall down into sin, we can get up again into faith. Because what the Bible speaks of as the continual cleansing of the blood, it speaks for Hebrews 9, how much more shall the blood of Christ keep cleansing your conscience? Now, that's not talking about the unredeemed, talking to the redeemed. Keep cleansing your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Dead works, of course, are self-effort works. Living works are God-effort works. How much more should the blood of Christ keep cleansing it? Because, in other words, always is this fact that in that act 2,000 years ago, everything that ever could be is finished. A whole lot's out. Past, present, future. So in a second, when I become consciously guilty again, quite right, I should be guilty as a conscious person. But the moment I'm there, I'm able to move over and say, oh, stop there. Stop there in God's sight, stop there in my sight. It's as quick seeing as quick cleansing. As our basis to continual freedom from guilt. But I'm moving on now to this second aspect, which must give us the basis of a complete redemption and renewal. It's Paul brings it into focus for us. I think Paul got a shock. As we'll see a little later on, I think there are very few of us find what we're talking about now in the one step when we first enter into a relationship with Christ. It's usually the second step which is involved here. I think it was in Paul. Because if I read it right, Paul made the second great discovery when he went to Arabia. Because he speaks a great deal about the second discovery in the Galatian letter. He opens it up in its fullness in the Roman letter, but he applies it in the Galatian letter. And in the Galatian letter he says he went to visit the journey into Arabia and went to Mount Sinai. The shocking gospel was he didn't find Mount Sinai there, he found Mount Zion there, which is much more convenient. Because he speaks of both of them. Mount Sinai is law, Mount Zion is grace. And he saw right into the hand of God for men who were called to see right through the thing. And he saw right through the implications of Christ crucified and Christ risen. And he saw here the implication as us. Now in one sense we had nothing to do with it. In one sense we all of us come to the foot of the cross and see this person who took our place and went through a certain process of bearing our sins in his own body on the tree, being made a curse for us, and having the judgment of God upon us for our sins in our place, and removed in his death, and verified by his resurrection. We don't touch that. We just come there, conditions us as sinners have disappeared. And we are in God's eyes, if it never was there. Never was there. But they're coming to the foot of the cross. But we've got to go beyond the foot of the cross. We've got to get on the cross. Now, Christ for us, you don't touch. That's the blood of Christ. Christ as us is we. That's why that second statement about the Holy Communion says, we're one bread, one body, because the body is part of you. And this says we're to regard ourselves as like when Christ's on the cross, we're there, and like a body, is part of you. One bread, one body. Now what is Paul saying about that, in that respect? He says, get this clear. If this person was humanity, humanity was there. Now you don't only come to the cross and say he died for me. You say, no, if he was humanity, I was there, therefore if he died, I died. And if he was buried, I was buried. If he rose, I rose. If he ascended, I ascended. We're getting too close in now. But this is the logic that keen mind could see. God uses all sorts. It's interesting to get out his great, apply his great revelations in the two dispensations. He used two trained minds. Moses in the old dispensation and Paul in the new. So God uses the fool and the wise, and he can only get much fewer wise. So it's trouble. No, I won't. Sorry. I didn't mean to be rude. I only meant I want to protect the wise, not run down too much. Sorry. I'll make peace with you afterwards. thank you. I'm saying Paul could see the total structure. And he said this. Now watch that, he says. Therefore, if this person was we, it was we. Now what does that mean, therefore it was we? What are we? We're people with a sin spirit inside us. Actually, as I said before, you'll never get the Bible right where it remains letters and words to you, or things. You only get the Bible right where it dissolves and becomes a person. And so even sin, it took me, it's a great revelation I suddenly saw, sin's a spirit. Sin is the character of the sin person. A sin, mind you, is just a spirit of satanism. You know that. It's just forms of self-egocentricity, is all. This satanic person. So sin really means it's the character of this satanic person. So sin's a spirit, really, same as using the Bible word holiness. He's the Holy Spirit. He's the spirit of love, the spirit of the products of self-giving love, of the fruits of the spirit and so on. He's the holiness in us. See what I mean? Jesus Christ is made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. The words dissolve. These tough, dry words. While the Bible remains dry to you, you can be sure it hasn't broken up to you yet. It lives, but there he is. But through the words you find a person. Words I speak to you, they're spirit, they're life. The lip that kills the spirit gives life. So I'm only saying this now. I'm saying this for a reason. Therefore, John's saying, look at this. Paul is saying, look at this. This with the whole humanity hanging there. And humanity is a human race which has got the wrong God inside it. It's got the spirit, who is the sin spirit, which is the spirit of selfness inside it. Therefore, Paul made a remark. He said, God made him to be sin for us. That's a change of. He'd always talk about bearing our sins. Now, sins are products. Things were things which had the wrath of God upon them and separated us from God, the judgment and the consequences and all that. Death was his blood. That was where he died in our place and took the curse upon himself. That's the other one. That's Christ dying for us. He isn't talking about sins here. He's talking about sin. Sin is the sin principle, sin spirit, sin person. Now, he suddenly says in 2 Corinthians 5:24 somewhere by there, he was made sin for us. Why? He says, look, Paul says, look, if he was humanity, he was a whole race which was being motivated by wrong God. And being motivated by wrong God is producing all the natural products of self-love, self-seeking, self-identification, naturally egocentric. Here he was, he says. Now, here he is, in God's sight, this was humanity, in this person, hanging on Calvary. And therefore, he, in God's sight, as it were, he was a humanity with this wrong spirit. Then he said he died. Now, it's very clear in the Bible, he really died. That was the evidence of the soldiers. They wouldn't break his legs, because he died, so they was to pierce his body. And out came the blood and water, which is the evidence of death. And a dead body was taken down. Why such importance? Because a death is separation between body and spirit. That's why. That's what death is. And therefore he's saying to us, look here, if this person represents humanity up there with the sin spirit, when he died, that separation, that humanity was separated from the sin spirit. Exactly. Exactly. This was what separated the whole humanity from the inner indwelling and control and outworking of this wrong spirit of self-centeredness which entered through the wrong tree all those years ago. This was the negative liberation. If we question about that, we'll go a little farther a little later and see how it works out. It works when you see its effects. Scientific hypothesis is proved by its effects, isn't it? Whether it works or not, we'll see. Now you get that Paul says to us, here's a dead body. It was we. This was humanity. This was humanity lying in a tomb, buried with him. Buried with him is a scripture expression. They were in that tomb, a dead body. Now Paul says, what can raise a dead body? Well, obviously only a spirit. A new spirit here. And therefore he says, Jesus Christ was put to death in the flesh, quickened by the Spirit. Quickened, like the new birth in the womb, the new life in the womb. Quickened by the Spirit. Here was his own Spirit, God, Spirit of self-giving love, coming into this body which was we. This is the new unity. Now this is the completed foundation for a permanent, perfect, indissoluble new unity taking place between God and the human spirit, the redeemed human spirit, in the place of the old one, the old one which went out in the death, and the new one. And the new one came in the resurrection. There's our foundation. That's how we can authoritatively, daringly, funnily, enjoyably be in this relationship. It isn't something we vaguely grasp and hope it's so. It's given us a great historical foundation. It should have a historical foundation if sin's in history, redemption has been history, certainly. That doesn't mean we live by historical Jesus, no. Paul's pretty bold. The Paul went on to say, yeah, if I knew him after the flesh, yet now I know him no more. I'm not joined now to a Jesus in the human flesh. I'm joined now to Jesus who is spirit, and yet that spirit has a body. There's a resurrection body. That's the basis for us having a resurrection body one day. So we ought to argue that just now. So there we are. So now we're saying this. I've taken this time to remind you of this total, square, historical foundation for us who are sinners in history. By which God provided in the person of his Son, which was himself, this complete redemption. Which is a unification of God and man. Now we have to ask this question, because we have time. Difficult in a way, of that aspect, not so much to a company like you, but to many, is that's the more historic type of thing. Where they say, oh, well, I don't know, that sort of thing happened 2,000 years ago, what's the matter to me anyhow? It wouldn't affect you so much, but that sort of, we've passed through a phase now, which we look back on something which happened. And what really matters, of course, is how does a general fact become a personal experience? How does the general facts of life become a personal experience? Because what matters to us is the personal experience. There is a perfectly simple law. Glenn has been emphasizing simplicity to us. Perfectly simple law in the working of the whole of the universe, I suppose, at least of this world. Because as we've had perfectly figured out, there's no spiritual sector, there's only one. Everything is a form of God, isn't it? It's God in certain forms, only one. Everything is a form of spirit. So there's one law touching through everything. The same law functions in what we call secular as functions in what we call spiritual, same thing. And that's what the Bible calls the law of faith. Now, faith has become rather a kind of commonplace word, or rather a word almost like a cliché, and may not always convey to us what it means. Perhaps if put in simple human terms, it's the law of supply and demand. Well, that brings us there where we live. It's the law of supply and demand. What do I mean the law of supply and demand? I mean this. The whole world is full of supplies. Again, I think I've touched on one of the previous talks. Full of supplies. Now, in a general sense, we have faith in those supplies. We believe air is air, and water is water, and the roof is the roof, and everything else. And in a general sense of convenience, a general faith doesn't affect us too closely. We just have, we live by general acceptance of faith and all sorts of things. In that sense, we recognize the supply. But a supply doesn't become a personal experience, except by those demands. When I have a personal demand, I'm conditioned then to appropriate my portion of the supply if it's available to me. And then something happens. And that's how we live. There's a general supply of food in this well-blessed country. Our stomachs have got the demand. And so with the supply and the demand, it's perfectly simple for us to appropriate the supply of the food. But watch, it isn't you who appropriate the food appropriates you. You find that out after you've eaten. Whether pleasant or unpleasant. Now here is the law of supply and demand. Is what takes you, what you take takes you. This is how you experience it. There are, we'll say, 300 chairs in this room. That's a general supply. Well, in a general way, yes, we all accept a general supply as a fact. Now the demand is you need one chair. Now here's your freedom. There's a supply, you've got a demand. Because it's available to you, you exercise your freedom, this is freedom, and you seat yourself in a chair. You're not holding that chair up, it's holding you up. Turn round. What you take, takes you. This is the law of faith. The takers took. The grabbers grabbed. This is the law of faith. This is the law of experience. And all through life. You come here by faith. That's to say, that you're told there's a supply of a conference here. A camp. There's a supply. Well, for some reason or other, you have a demand. You say, I'd like to come. All right then, your faith is, your freedom is, you book and you come. Here you are. Now the took us took, because you've got to sit and take what you get. You can't escape. See, you're done for. Now all life is like that. People try to mistake that. Faith isn't getting, faith is being got. And this is the beauty of life. Life consists of experiences which have got you. Every one of us here has got a trade. Maybe you're a housewife, maybe you're a musician, maybe you're a lawyer, a doctor, a carpenter, whatever it is. You've been taken over by your trade. You started by taking it over. You started by learning and apprenticing yourself to this and this and this. At time, 10 times, it became part of you, it caught you. And you're just a natural carpenter, or a natural doctor, or a natural housewife, a natural so-so. This is the beauty of life. And you move into beautiful spontaneity when you've been captured by what you first captured. This is life. So faith, what we call faith, has never become faith until you've been taken over. This is the key to the gospel. You don't take God, you're taken over by God. That's the fun. See, I move among circles where they're always anxious to try and hold on to God. That's hard work. Trying to hold on to God. Yourself, by holding on to God, you hold on to nothing else besides. The gospel's not holding on to God, it's being got hold of by God, and you're done for. There you are, and you live. You dare to live free because you're caught. This is the gospel. Now this is faith. So the plain put in those terms is the law of supply and demand. Where does the supply, where does the demand, we express our freedom, usually it's fairly easy. When there's a supply and when there's demand, and you know the two, it's fairly easy. It's saying, thank you. And you don't know you're being caught, you don't recognize that until afterwards. And that's what the gospel is. Now the difference on what we may call the spiritual level and the material, I don't like to use those words, but for convenience sake, is this. The laws, the demands in the material level are pretty obvious, are pretty constant. There's not a demand on the spiritual level, the devil seems to that. There's not a demand on the spiritual level. The demand's got to be created. You haven't got to create a demand in your stomach for too long. You haven't got to create a demand in your lungs for too long. It's pretty quickly there. But God has created us a demand for this supply we're talking about, which is the meaning of life, the union between God and ourselves. So there has to be a preliminary work of God by which he creates a demand. Thank God he does. I needn't go, I don't want to spend too much time on that, go too far into what is obvious, but it's obvious to us here. By different ways, God has created that demand in us. That's the value of the gospel and preaching and the Bible and the inner law, which we touched on again this morning. Thank God, our very being is God. Because our very being is God, we know what we ought to be, thank God. There it is. And that law comes up here as you ought to be, why aren't you? And so by different ways, the inner law, the outer law, the gospel, crises and so on, the demands created. The moment of truth in life comes where at last we become honest to the demand, honest to the situation. Now we all start, the consequences of law on us, whether it's the outer law or the inner law, our reaction to the laws, to the law is always either hypocrisy or honesty. Hypocrisy damns. Honesty is the way to salvation. We all start by hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is, I'm not going to let on, I don't do it. So we keep a few very convenient commandments. We all most carefully keep the 11th. That should not be found out. We're sure on that one. Keep them behind. So we start, all of us start life by a mask. We're trying to run away from the condition. The true condition of all humanity is despair. Humanity must be in despair because humanity is a combination of finite and infinite. And we can't live a finite life, which is a worldly life, and try and just escape the infinite. Down on the sense of despair all the time. So, actually lost humanity consists of two types. There's the type who try and run away and escape from facing out the real implications of life. Or there's the type who try to bluff it out and try to affirm a false independent self. You either run away from yourself and hide yourself by all sides of interests, or you try to affirm yourself by yourself. Both have a bottom of despair. Because we're not relating to the infinite. And you can't escape that. Man is a combination of infinite and finite. You can't escape. So thank God for the despair. The moment of truth is when at last we face the despair. That's when we become honest. That's when we come at last, by some means or other, say, yes, I am wrong. I have broken God's laws. I am separate from him. And so forth and so forth. That is what I sometimes call the first collapse. It's the collapse on our righteousness. And not easy, because the whole basis of the fall is self-sufficiency, self-righteousness, self-justification, pride. Not easy. So for that breaking, it's not easy enough for us to admit I'm wrong. I'm out. My religion's a camouflage. Facts are my sins. No, it's not easy. And none of us have come except by that way. I'm not saying in many cases sudden, maybe that doesn't matter, it's come that way. Now that's the demand. So I'm jumping back quickly. Each of us, I trust in this room, we've come to that demand, somewhere or other. Now, when there's a demand, if there's a supply, it's easy to move into freedom and participate in the supply. That's the benefit of the gospel. I go to many nations where there's no gospel. There are ways, occasionally, in which people can find God without. I won't discuss that now. That's just a private heresy of my own. But that is much more difficult. Much more difficult. It's easy for us because it's thank God for Jesus Christ. It's easy for us. Thank God for the gospel. Therefore, let us never run down our churches. No. Anyhow, the Word of God is there to some extent. Anyhow, the Scripture is being read. Something's being said. Yes, thank God if anybody goes to church at all, anyhow. Because something's dropping in. Now, I'm an Episcopalian, so I belong to a true church. I'm sorry to rest on it. Tommy and Carl, way out, you Methodists. You left us all ago. Way out. As for Baptists, you can't see them at all. They're under the water. So I belong to true. And how bored stiff I was for 18 years. A vibrant young fellow. What's this business of Jesus Christ dying for me and saying prayers? We had to go to we had those boarding schools in England. Boys. I like a boys' boarding school. No girls to make a nuisance. Just boys. But we had chapel every day. We had conveniently high pews and used to keep our preparation books under the pews while the parson moaned on with his prayers. But never mind. All that time, something's dropping in. The moment of truth for me was 18 years of age, and I suddenly did see, I needn't say that, I did see my condition. Somehow I came to see it, and because I've been taught, I was brought up to a personal question. I was suddenly asked by a retired army major who used to get after our souls. He had a nice tennis lawn. We went for tennis, he went for our souls. We tried to avoid the souls and get the tennis. Well, we're so successful. And he asked me, do you belong to Christ? For the unpleasant lady, he said, do you belong to the church? Yes. But I'd just begun to doubt the person. We all ought to doubt. Thank God for good doubts. Is God real at all? What's his business? And I couldn't say I belong to a person. I could say I belong to a religion. Now is a moment of truth. That cost me something. I was only a young fellow, but I was son of a parson. So like Tommy, of course, we're perfection, perhaps. But it cost me something. Having been through all the forms of Christianity, I nearly lied. You can lie to yourself to hell. That's hypocrisy. I nearly did. But I just got it out to say, well, I couldn't say I was. I did belong to Christ. But that suddenly brought me up sharp because of the teaching. Now, he got me down on my knees, made me mumble something. I got up just as I went down. I was supposed to say a prayer of salvation or something. It didn't work very well. But what had God said had gone inside. And as I was going home, I said, oh, look, if I can't say I belong to Christ, I'm lost. If I can't say Christ is my Savior and I knew my sins, I'm lost. I'm going to hell. I'm out from God. That's teaching. Because I've been taught in the church without being bored stiff all the time, thinking more of football than anything else, but it was dropping in. I knew the gospel. So when I was ready for it, oh, if I can't say Christ is my Savior, I'm lost. I'm going to get on with that one. Now, there was real this time. I really saw myself separate from God. I really saw my sins for me, and I realized I deserved to go to heaven. Hell, not heaven. And so in a very simple way, I went into my room and knelt down and asked God to forgive my sins. And my salvation was almost like a mental recognition. Oh, that's it. Now I see. That's what the blood meant. Oh, I see. And because he died for me, I don't have to go to hell. My sins are forgiven. Oh, I said. And a joy came to my heart as a young fellow of 18, because God was my father and heaven was my home. Well, football season was starting. And the devil has played his eye. He says, oh, that's emotion. You think football tomorrow morning. I didn't. And I've not been thinking for 47 years now. Next morning I woke up. God's my father. Heaven's my home. This is it. See, you know, so you see, where there's a demand, where there's a supply, you can have. But this, I think, is the last thing I'd be able to say this morning, this afternoon. I'll say this. Because this is important. What's the effect? Now, what we're saying is this. The only meaning of all this is that God... this person who is nothing but love, which means his life is involved in others, living other people's lives, and we become part of him, and so we then become eternal love, and life for us is, the meaning of life for us is involved in others, the gaiety, fullness, completion of life is a way in which we can be other people, live other people's lives, and so on. Eternal love. Now watch this. The evidence of redemption is the evidence of redemption is what? It's the birth of the eternal love in you. That's the evidence of redemption. What I mean is this. When you first, whatever way it was, first connected with Jesus Christ in your need, and he became a real Savior to you, for the first time you see something happen inside you, you acknowledge yourself, taken into you the person who is love. You didn't know that. You've taken Jesus Christ is love. What effect on you? For the first time in your human history, you began to love somebody else more than yourself. That's the eternal love. Up to that moment, you loved yourself first. You may have loved a few other people so far as it's convenient. But at this moment, there began in you a love for somebody more than for yourself. that Jesus Christ had died for you, the God who gave you, and you began to prove it by making choices and making decisions and deciding to engage yourself for Him, you've begun. Now, in our ignorance, we think that that's just we loving. Oh, no, we can't have self-giving love. We're self-loving love. This is the birth of the eternal love. This is the birth of the person in you who is the self-giving love. Joining himself to you, and you've begun to be it. And the scripture which is given at that time is in Romans 5. That's the chapter on when we receive Christ, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. And it says this, listen. For the love of God, not love for God, for God's love is shed abroad in your hearts by the Holy Spirit, who's given unto you. So, what you've begun to be, I said to you, that historic redemption meant that we in Christ, there had been a throw out from us of that spirit of self-centeredness, this capturing humanity. And a union into us of the spirit of self-giving love, which is God. And so we become the eternal love. This is the proof. But when you do, even in the most elementary form, first relate to Jesus Christ, you can't help yourself. You begin to love the one who died for you. You begin to love the God who sent you. This is the eternal love. And you find yourself caught out. Because you learn that God's not vertical, He's horizontal. He doesn't come down this way, He's here. He's people. And you can't love Jesus Christ without loving the world. And you're for it. Poor you. Spend all the rest of your life wriggling out of it. You can. You can't. You've begun the stream. Well, the Amazon River starts with a trickle somewhere. It ends the Amazon. A prairie fire starts in this park, ends the fire. So however big the stream has begun in us. So I'm going to stop there. Now I want to take that further, because it hasn't actually settled us completely yet in this unity relationship. There's some more to come yet. But this is the start. And we'll proceed from that. Thank you.